My last movie, one of my favorite movies based on a true story of heroism of the U.S. military, has to be, of course, the 1995 version of one of the greatest stories ever told of World War II, the Tuskegee Airmen. Now, remember, I'm talking about the 1995 version that was produced by HBO, not the one that was created by Lucasfilm Limited. I'll explain it later. But this one, this movie actually gave me, this is perhaps the first time I can remember that I was ever introduced to the Tuskegee Airmen. The first time I ever actually heard about these men. And this movie gave us an amazing story about what these men went through to become Air Force pilots, to become combat pilots, to helping winning the war or in Europe in a time where our country had no respect for them. This movie has a who's who of amazing actors in this one, including Lawrence Fishburne as Captain Hannibal Lee, E. Jr., Alan Payne as Cadet Walter Peebles, Cosby star are Malcolm Jamal Warner as Leroy Cappy, Courtney B. Vance as Second Lieutenant Glenn, Andre Bernau as real-life colonel and commander of the 99th Squadron, Benjamin O. Davis Jr., Christopher McDonald as Major Sherman Joy, one of the instructors, is when they were going through camp. Daniel Hugh Kelly as Colonel Earl Mo Rogers, commander of Tuskegee Airfield. And with John Lithgow as Senator Quarters, a man who was trying to keep the Tuskegee Airmen out of the air. And Cuba Gooding Jr., a freshman winning his Academy Award from Jerry Maguire as Lieutenant Billy Roberts. And the thing about, and the small side note about Cuba Gooding Jr., he was in this film as well as Red Tails. But as I said, I'm going to get to that in a few moments after I give you the synopsis of this movie. Now, what I really love about this particular movie is that we get to see these men go from college-educated African-American men to becoming Air Force pilots, facing racism, bigotry, and their own fears of dying in the air. There. Now, Tuskegee obviously was one of the greatest stories ever told about the African-American in this country when it comes to the U.S. military. These men going from college boys to United States Army Air Corps officers to becoming combat pilots. Unfortunately, people in high places in Congress and the Senate didn't see it that way, didn't think that they were capable of becoming pilots. Enter Senator Crevers, played by, of course, John Lithgow. As much as I like John Lithgow, and trust me, I do, he's an amazing actor, he's a funny guy and all, this is the one role where I wish I could, I'm not even gonna go there. He's a stone cold racist. Even while the world is at war, He lets his racism show when it comes to these group of amazing men. And he's not the only one. Christopher McDonald's character, Major Sherman Joy, their direct instructor, shared that bigotry as well. Now, you may remember Chris McDonald from, of course, Happy Gilmore. Sorry, I get those two mixed up all the time. They're Adam Sandler movies, so I get those two mixed up. Anyway, despite all the obstacles those put in front of them, these men became Air Corps aviators. Even after months of staying stagnant at Tuskegee, a visit from Eleanor Roosevelt got them into the war. Before long, these men were assigned to the North African campaign as dive bombers, taking out supply trucks, supply stations, things of that nature. And the mood there was pretty, and when they get to North Africa, they meet their squadron commanding officer of the 99th Fighter Squadron, Lieutenant Colonel Benjamin O. Davis, played by Andre Bergnau. Now, Benjamin L. Davis, in case you remember, was a real-life fighter pilot. He rose up to the ranks to become a three-star general and then became a four-star posthumously thanks to President Clinton. At this point in time in the war, they were only relegated to dive bombing, destroying supply trucks, things of that nature. They didn't see air-to-air combat until one point in time where one of those pilots was actually killed. Malcolm Jamal Warner's character, Billy Roberts. Now, in one of my favorite scenes of this movie, a congressional hearing with the Armed Services Committee was meeting in order to find out whether or not the Tuskegee Airmen should continue. And in a daring mood, Colonel Davis met with the committee and testified before them, giving them the unbridled truth as to why these men are in the cockpit.
Every colored pilot in the 99th went through his own private hell to wear those wings. Every one of those men carry not only the burden of their dreams of becoming American military aviators, but the hopes of an entire people as well. Am I the only one in this room that understands just what that means? I was brought up to believe that beneath it all, Americans are a decent people with an abiding sense of integrity and fair play. The cheers I heard across this country when Joe Louis and Jesse Owens humiliated Hitler's master race didn't just come from proud colored folks. They came from everyone. How are we to interpret that? As a United States Army officer who gladly puts his life on the line every day, there's no greater conflict within me. How do I feel about my country? And how does my country feel about me? Are we only to be Americans when the mood suits you? A fair and impartial opportunity is all we ask. Nothing that you yourselves wouldn't demand.
Not too long after that testimony before the Senate Armed Services Committee, the 99th Squadron was actually reassigned to the European theater, most specifically Ramitalli, Italy. Once there, they were followed by three other squadrons that made it out of Tuskegee. Unfortunately, they were all African-American squadrons, so the army was segregating once again. And their mission inside Italy went from dive bombing to bomber escort. Another reason why they were assigned to the European theater. The B-17 Flying Fortresses, the heavy bombers, were experiencing heavy, extreme losses in their runs in the Axis and Nazi-occupied territory. During one of those deployments, they saved numerous bombers and even destroyed a Nazi destroyer. Unfortunately, a lot of the attitude that's in the 332nd is no matter what they do, it won't be good enough for the rest of the country to recognize them as combat pilots, as real Americans. Unfortunately, one of their pilots didn't make it out of one of the bombing runs. Cuba Gooding Jr.'s character, Billy A. Train Roberts. Before the end of the movie, two amazing things happened. Hannibal Lee, Lawrence Fishburne's character, was awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross for taking out the destroyer I mentioned. And secondly...
Yes, sir. Well, I got men whose lives are my responsibility up there, sir. And I want the 332nd as our escort.
The colored boys?
That's right, sir. I looked into it, and since they've been escorting bombers, they haven't lost one to enemy action, sir. Not a single ship. And if it's all the same to you, I want the 332nd to take me to Berlin and back.
White pilots flying the B-17 Flying Fortresses requested that the 332nd, an all-black squadron, take them to one of the biggest bombing missions of the war. The bombing of Germany, of Britain itself. Now, at the end of the movie, we get some pretty impressive numbers from the Tuskegee Airmen. Now, there are some historical inaccuracies in this, saying that the Tuskegee Airmen under their escort never lost a single bomber to enemy action. Unfortunately, that was not true. According to Air Force records, at least 25 bombers were lost to enemy fire. But this was still an excellent loss to the enemy ratio, considering the fact that for every bomber they lost, more and more of the enemies were as well. And they also took on the first jet fighters of the war for the Germans. Now, again, the reason why I like this movie, aside of Red Tails that was released decades later, is because the historical accuracy that was put into this movie, especially the main character of Benjamin O. Davis, who after the war rose to the ranks becoming a general. And also showed the amazing courage that these men took when they were calling people like them college-educated Negroes instead of Americans in the time of war where the entire world was at war. These men, the Tuskegee Airmen, personify courage, honor, and duty. Everything that everyone in the that wore the uniform, everyone that really wore the uniform, should understand and should take to heart. Now, the reason why I picked this movie outside of Red Tails, don't get me wrong. Red Tails, the movie that was produced and made by Lucasfilm Limited, and was directed by Anthony Hemingway, was just an amazing movie. But I think that I couldn't get past that no accurate characters were actually made into this movie. And more to the point, it felt more like, I couldn't get past the computer-generated images. Now, if you looked at the Red Tails, you'll see real P-51s being flown. And more to the point, when you see some combat action sequences, most of it was actually gun camera footage from the Tuskegee Airmen missions back in the 40s. Now, as much as I like this Tuskegee Airmen from 1995, Red Tails is just as good, but it just wasn't up there with me. And even having people like Cuba Gooding Jr., Terrence Howard, in that movie, it just didn't really resonate with me as the 1995 film did. But both tell the same story, and both of them tell the amazing story of a group of African Americans who fought for a country that didn't fight for them back. Every time I think about these men, these amazing people, it reminds me of a quote from one of these airmen, which said that when someone asks, who were the Tuskegee Airmen? Just a bunch of good old red-blooded Americans and who went out and did their job and did it well without any expectation of recognition or fanfare. We just did what we had to do, and we're proud of it. Donald Egler, Army Air Corps, World War II. I want to thank you all for watching these videos, hanging with me for the last 5 days. If you think that there's a film that I didn't mention in the last 5 days on my list, feel free to tell me on the description below. Let me know. Thanks again for watching.